Hello all. So let's discuss about autoquoids. So in autoquoids, we will discuss about the introduction to autoquoids and we will discuss about histamine. Okay, in this section we will discuss about histamine. So let's see, what do we mean by the word autoquoids? Okay, now autoquoid means they are also known as local hormones. They are also known as local hormones. That means, suppose there is a cell and this cell synthesizes a certain chemical, and this chemical, remember, it acts locally near the site of its synthesis. So where they are synthesized, they act locally. Suppose they are synthesized, they will act in a side cell, the cell which is beside to it, or on the own cell. So remember, they will act in a paracrine. Paracrine means they are acting on a cell which is adjacent to it. Suppose A cell is synthesizing, it is acting on B cell. So it is acting in paracrine or in autocrine fashion. Okay, so they act in a paracrine or autocrine fashion. They act locally out here. Okay, and point is, remember, they have a very brief duration of action. Why? Because they become rapidly degraded. They get rapidly degraded. That is why they have a very brief duration of action. Okay, now let's classify these autoquoids. Let's classify them. So they are also known as local hormone. Why? Because they are synthesized, rapidly degraded, and act locally out there only. Now let's see what are the different types of autoquoids we have. We divide autoquoids on the basis of their chemical nature. Okay? On the basis of their chemical nature. On this basis, we will try to divide autoquoids into four types. Okay? Four types. The first one is autoquoids which are having a chemical structure of amine. Okay, amine. Among amine, we have two autoquoids. One is histamine and second is serotonin. Now remember, another name of serotonin is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. It is also known as 5-hydroxytryptamine. So as you see, amine word is coming out here. Okay, so they are amine in structure. Then we have certain autoquoids or local hormones which are derived from lipids or fats. Okay, they are derived from a lipid known as eicosatetraenoic acid. That is why they are known as eicosanoids. Okay, so they are known as eicosanoids because they are derived from some eicosatetraenoic acid. Among these lipid-derived autoquoids, we have prostaglandins, we have leukotrienes, we have thromboxane, and lastly, we have lipoxins. So they all are derived from a lipid precursor known as eicosatetraenoic acid. Okay. Now next we have is peptides. Peptides are the chains of amino acids. Okay. Peptides means small chain of amino acid. So among them we have bradykinin. We have angiotensin. Neurotensin, urotensin, various kinins, and lastly endothelins. Okay, we have endothelins, and lastly we have a gaseous autoquoid which is in a gas form. The name of that autoquoid is nitric oxide gas. Okay, nitric oxide. Okay. So in the chapter of autocoids, we will be discussing about various details of the drugs which will act at the level of histamine, serotonin. We will discuss about all these lipid autocoids, and we will discuss about bradykinin and endothelin. Okay. Remember, the drugs which act on angiotensin, it is covered in cardiovascular system ACE inhibitors, and we don't have any drug generally acting at this level. And we will also discuss about nitric oxide. Okay. So certain drugs are irrelevant for us in point of pharmacology. Okay. So let's discuss in this section about histamine. So let's discuss about histamine in this section. Okay. So let's make a heading: histamine. Okay, so from where we have gathered this name histamine, or what is the etymology or the name? Histamine means tissue, or histos means tissue. It is also known as tissue amine. Okay, it is also known as tissue amine because the word histos means tissue. So it was one of the autocoid which was earlier identified in some tissue, but at that time we don't know the origin of this autocoid, so we name it as histamine. Let's see how this histamine is synthesized, how this histamine is synthesized inside the cell. Okay, remember, any amine containing autocoid is synthesized from an amino acid. It is synthesized from an amino acid known as histidine. So it is synthesized from amino acid. Similarly, we will be discussing that serotonin, which is 5-hydroxytryptamine, it is synthesized from tryptophan. Now, you know that in an amino acid, one part of amino acid contains COOH and another part of amino acid contains NH2. This part is amine. This part is known as carboxylic acid. This part is known as carboxylic acid. Now, the simple point is, if you will remove this carboxylic acid part, the remaining part of this amino acid, it just contain amine. Okay, so if you will remove carboxylic group from this histidine, it will become histamine. Okay, so the enzyme which is required to convert histidine into histamine, we have to remove carboxylic group, it will become only and only amine. So this enzyme is known as histidine decarboxylase enzyme. So the enzyme name is histidine decarboxylase enzyme, and this enzyme converts histidine amino acid into histamine. So it will remove this COOH part or carboxylic group part. That is why it is having a word decarboxylase. Okay, now let's see what is the source in which cells it is present. Okay, now histamine is present in various WBC, white blood cells, known as macrophages, and basophils. Okay, histamine is present in various WBC, macrophages, and basophil. And remember, when macrophages and basophil, they release histamine outside, they mediate various allergic reaction. Okay, allergic reaction, and this type of allergic reaction is known as anaphylactic reactions. Anaphylactic reaction, or type 1 hypersensitivity, or type 1 hypersensitivity. Now it is also present in our GIT cells. In GIT, it is specially present in stomach. And these cells are known as enterochromaffin cell, or they are also known as, which secrete histamine, they are also known as histaminocyte. Now remember, when these cells, they release histamine, remember, it increases HCl production. So histamine, remember, it increases the production of acid inside our stomach, which helps in digestion. Now also, histamine is present in neurons also, in our brain, especially outside the brain also. It is also present in neurons, and it has variety of functions. So in brain it act as a neurotransmitter. So in brain it act as a neurotransmitter. And in brain it has various functions. Remember, it is responsible to maintain wakefulness. Histamine, when released, it maintains wakefulness. So it is important to maintain our sleep-wake cycle, known as circadian rhythm. It is also a component of memory, and it generally improves or increases memory. Lastly, it also is responsible for vertigo-like effect, especially in the area of inner ear that we will be discussing shortly. Okay. Now, there is one point you have to remember, which is clinically related in our patient also. Suppose this is a mast cell. We know that in mast cell, histamine are present. Sorry, macrophages or mast cells. Okay, you can also write mast cells also with basophil. They're also present in mast cells. Suppose, sir, this is a macrophage or a mast cell. Remember, in a mast cell or in macrophages, this histamine, remember, it is a basic molecule in our WBC, and it is attached to a molecule known as heparin. It is attached to a molecule known as heparin. And remember, heparin is the strongest acidic substance of our body. Heparin is the strongest acidic substance of our body. Now, the point is, remember, when these mast cells or macrophages, they release histamine. When they release histamine, this is known as anaphylaxis. It is known as anaphylaxis. Okay. Now, remember, there is a point that if we will give some basic drug from outside, this basic drug, if you will give from outside, it will enter into the mast cell and it will bind to heparin. Okay. This basic cell will enter into the mast cell and it will bind to the acidic substance heparin. Okay. And when it will bind to heparin, remember, this histamine will become free. And these basic cells, they have a propensity to release histamine. These basic cells, they have propensity to release histamine. Okay. So, can we say that basic drugs, they release histamine from the mast cells, basophils, etc. Okay. And this reaction due to this basic drugs is known as anaphylactoid reaction. It is known as anaphylactoid reaction because it is similar to anaphylaxis, which is an allergic reaction. Okay. So, what are the examples of those basic drugs which can release histamine from the mast cells and macrophages? The examples are, we will write morphine. Morphine is a basic drug and it releases histamine from the mast cell. That is why morphine causes bronchial asthma. And intense pruritus. These are allergic reactions. Similarly, there is a drug, basic drug, vancomycin. It's an antibiotic. And because of this reason, when vancomycin is given, it displaces histamine from heparin. Histamine will become free and released out. That is why vancomycin causes massive histamine release, which is known as Redman syndrome. Why Redman syndrome? Because whole body will become red because histamine causes vasodilatation. Okay. Similarly, there are other drugs also, like curare-like drug, like D-tubocurare. They are skeletal muscle relaxant. So all curare like drug, they cause histamine release from the mast cell. And other basic drugs which we can write, like atropine, polymyxin and pentamidine. Okay. So these are the certain examples of basic drugs which displace histamine from the mast cell. They themselves will bind to acidic heparin. So try to remember these three drugs. Okay. Now let's talk about, so this is the effect of histamine in our body. Let's talk about how histamine is degraded. Remember, any amine molecule is degraded by an enzyme known as MAO enzyme. माउस स्टैंड फॉर मोनो अमीन, एज यू सी अमीन वर्ड इज कमिंग ऑक्सीडेज, सो इट इज डिग्रेडेड बाय एन एंजाइम मोनोअमीन ऑक्सीडेज. देर आर अदर एंजाइम्स ऑल्सो लाइक डाई अमीन ऑक्सीडेज एज वेल, बट वट इज मोर इंपॉर्टेंट माओ एंजाइम. ओके, माओ एंजाइम. नाउ लेट्स सी वट आर द इफेक्ट्स ऑफ हिस्टामीन वी सी इन अवर बॉडी. ओके, सो इफेक्ट्स ऑफ हिस्टामीन. Effects of histamine. To see the effect of histamine, we must know histamine acts on which receptors. So we will write histamine receptors. So histamine act on receptors. Okay. So let's see where they are located and what is their function. But before that, remember there are four receptors of histamine, and all receptors of histamine are GPCR. That is G protein coupled receptors. Okay, now remember there are four receptors of histamine in our body. There are four receptors. They are named as 1, 2, 3, 4, like H1, H2, H3 and H4. So these are the fourth receptor. This H4 has recently been identified. Okay. Now first point is, sir, what type of GPCR they are? Which type of GPCR they are? Remember, H1 receptor, it is GQ type. H2, GS type. So Q and S are stimulatory receptor. Okay. H3 is GI. I means inhibitory. And H4 is also GI type. Inhibitory receptor. Now remember, any receptor which is of GQ type, remember, it acts by increasing the level of IP3 DAG inside the cell. IP3 DAG stand for inositol triphosphate diacyl glycerol, and GS type, it also increases cyclic AMP level inside the cell and the cell becomes excitatory. And GI type, remember, they reduce cyclic AMP level inside the cell and the cell becomes inhibited. These IP3 DAG, cyclic AMP are known as second messenger, which produces effect inside the cell. Okay. Now let's see where they are present and what is their function. So if you talk about first, that is H1 receptor. H1 receptor, remember, their function is, main function is, they mediate allergic response. They mediate allergic response, and their allergic response is sometimes known as triple response. This is known as triple response. So triple response to histamine is by H1 receptor. Okay. Now remember, they are also present elsewhere also. They are also present in muscles. And in muscles, the muscles will become excitable and the muscle will contract. So in muscles, they cause muscle contraction. So because of this reason, when histamine releases, it causes bronchoconstriction. So it can lead to asthma. Okay. It also causes vasoconstriction by acting on smooth muscles of blood vessel. Okay, but there is a point you have to note out here, that it is also present on blood vessels. In the blood vessel, they are also present on endothelial cell. Okay, so you know that in a blood vessel, innermost we have an endothelial cell, and below endothelial cell we have muscles. Okay, now if histamine directly act on muscle, it produces vasoconstriction. But remember, if histamine act on endothelial cell, these endothelial cell, they increase synthesis of a gas known as nitric oxide. So they release nitric oxide, and nitric oxide goes inside the muscles and causes vasodilatation or muscle relaxation. So histamine normally produces vasodilatation. Why? because muscles are protected by endothelial cells. So when histamine comes into the blood, remember, it does not produce vasoconstriction. It produces vasodilatation in an intact blood vessel. But if this blood vessel is damaged, suppose this endothelial cell is damaged, now if you will be giving this histamine, it will produce vasoconstriction. So histamine produces vasoconstriction in damaged blood vessel. In an intact blood vessel, it produces vasodilatation, and overall you will say that histamine produces vasodilatation. Okay, vasodilatation. Now, it also has effect in our CNS, brain. In brain, histamine, remember, by H1 receptor, it maintains wakefulness or circadian rhythm. Circadian rhythm. Okay. And it also acts as a neurotransmitter. It is also responsible for memory. So remember, if you will block histamine 1 receptor, the person will have sedation and memory loss. The person will have sedation and memory loss. Okay, so remember this point. It also responsible for in certain endocrine functions are there. Endocrine. Remember, histamine also H1 receptor, it also act on stomach to release gastrin. And also remember, histamine also act on adrenal medulla to increase the release of catecholamines. But it is not the major function. It's a very minor function, which is not very important for us. Okay. Catecholamines. Catecholamines are epinephrine, norepinephrine, dopamine, etc. Okay. So these are the examples of H1 receptor. Before coming to H2, let's see what do we mean by triple response. Triple response of histamine. Triple response of histamine is seen when we give intradermal injection of histamine. It is seen in intradermal injection of histamine, and it mediates through which receptor? H1 receptor mediates triple response of histamine. It's a kind of allergic response. In triple response, three things are seen. That is why it has got the name triple. First of all, the patient will suffer from redness in that area. There will be redness. Then there will be wheal or edema. Then there will be flare. Flare means it will spread. Now, why there is redness when we give histamine? Because of vasodilatation. It is because of vasodilatation of arterioles or the blood vessels which are before capillaries or pre-capillary vessels. Why there is wheal? Wheal is because there is edema, and edema occurs. It is edema because of vasodilatation or dilatation of vessels which are beyond capillaries. Okay, which is due to vasodilatation, which leads to increase in permeability. Permeability of post capillary. We know that before capillary there are arteries, and after capillary there are veins. So very small veins are known as venules. Okay, and why there is flare? Why this will flare up? Because the local nerves out there, histamine will act on this local nerves, and histamine will stimulate this axon part of this local nerve, and due to this there is release of many other chemical mediators which will spread this inflammation. So why there is flare? Flare is due to a mechanism known as axon reflux. Axon reflex. Okay, axon reflex, what it will do, it will be the axon part of a nerve will be stimulated by histamine, and it will release vasodilator chemicals. Now the neuron will release vasodilatory or inflammatory chemicals which will increase the inflammation, which will flare up or increase it. Okay, so, so this is known as triple response of histamine. Okay, now let's talk about where H2 receptors are present. Where H2 receptors are present? H2 receptor, they are present mainly in stomach. H2 receptors, they are mainly present in stomach, and in stomach it is responsible to increase HCl production, because H2 receptors, they are present in parietal cells of the stomach. So if you will block this H2 receptor, the level of cyclic AMP will reduce and the HCl production will reduce. Okay, so we will discuss that part. Now H3 receptors, remember, they are presynaptic autoreceptor. It means, suppose there is an organ, let's say neuron, it is releasing a histamine, let's say neuro, as a neurotransmitter. Normally the receptor should be present on other areas, on other cells. So this area is generally known as synapse. So normally we say that the receptor should be present on other cells. So these receptors are known as postsynaptic receptor. But remember, there are certain receptors which are present on same neuron which is releasing this histamine. So H3 receptor are presynaptic autoreceptor. Okay, and remember, when histamine, when released, act on this same receptor on the same neuron, it will release, it will apply a brake, or it will reduce the further release of histamine. That is why they are inhibitory receptor. Okay, so it will, what is the function? They will reduce, decrease histamine release. So they will reduce histamine release. And they are present in whole body, each and every cell of our body. So can we say, when we will stimulate H3 receptor, can we say it will decrease allergic response? Histamine will not release. It will cause vasodilatation. Agreed? It will reduce sleep. It will reduce memory. It will reduce acid secretion. So can we say that H3 receptors, they are inhibitory receptor, they will reduce everything. So let's make a summary, what things they will reduce. Can we say that they will reduce wakefulness? They will decrease wakefulness. And hence the person will sleep. Okay. Can we say they will also inhibit bronchoconstriction? Because they will inhibit the release of histamine. Similarly, they will inhibit acid release from histaminocyte. So they are present. So they will make the effect of H1 and H2 receptors totally opposite. They will inhibit HCl release. Can we say that they will also reduce or inhibit catecholamine release? So what effect you have written of H1 and H2 receptor, all these effects will reduce by H3 receptor. Okay. Now lastly, because they are presynaptic receptor, they inhibit the release of histamine from the cells. Now lastly, we have H4 receptor. Now H4 receptor, remember, it has been recently been found on those WBCs which we have written. And remember, in WBC, they are responsible for chemotaxis. The full mechanism of these receptors are still to be elucidated, but in WBC, they are responsible for chemotaxis, and we don't have any drug which will act on H4 receptor. So H4 receptor right now is irrelevant for us. So the drugs generally we have are for three receptors, H1, H2 and H3. Okay, so we just have the drugs which will act on H1, H2 and H3. So let's start in opposite fashion. Let's see first about the drugs among H3, drug acting on H2, and lastly the major part, drugs acting on H1 receptor. Okay, so let's talk about first the drugs various on histamine receptor. Okay, so the first receptor we have is H3 receptor, and we know H3 receptor normally decreases histamine release. It decreases histamine release, hence the person generally sleeps. We have discussed, the person will sleep. Now we have one drug, recently a new drug, which act on H3 receptor. The drug we have is Tiprolisant. The drug name is Tiprolisant. Remember, Tiprolisant is also known as Pitolisant. Okay. And Tiprolisant, what is the mechanism of action? Triprolisant is an H3 inverse agonist. Now, inverse agonist produces opposite effect. Normally, H3 receptor decreases histamine. Inverse agonist means they will produce opposite effect. It increases histamine release. And can we say when it is increased histamine release in brain, the person will wake up and the person will not sleep. Because of this reason, this triprolisant has recently been approved for the treatment of a person who sleeps during daytime. We don't want that person to sleep during daytime. It has been approved for a condition known as narcolepsy. Okay? And remember, there is one drug which has already been approved for the treatment of narcolepsy to maintain wakefulness. That was modafinil. But remember, modafinil is not an antihistaminic drug. Modafinil was a sympathetic drug. So this drug, triprolisant, it is an inverse agonist at H3 receptor, a new drug for the treatment of narcolepsy. Okay. Now, then we have a drug which act on H2 receptor. So we have only one drug which act on H3 receptor. And the drug which act on H2 receptor we are having are H2 blockers. And we know that normally H2 receptor, it increases HCL production by increasing cyclic AMP level inside the stomach cell. So H2 blocker, remember, they will reduce HCL production by decreasing cyclic AMP level inside the cell. Because of this reason, these drugs are used in the treatment of acid peptic disease. Okay, or peptic ulcers. So the drugs are cimetidine. It was the first H2 blocker. Ranitidine. Okay. Famotidine. Nizatidine, etc. Now remember, these drugs have been discussed in great detail. Please refer to the videos of GIT and please refer to the topic acid peptic disease, where we have discussed all the drugs which are used for the treatment of acid peptic disease. Okay, refer to the videos of GIT. So let's talk about now the last receptor, which is very important, that is H1 receptor. Okay, and we know that H1 receptor has various functions. Now, the first drug which we have, which act as an H1 on H1 receptor, we have only two classes of drug. The first one we have is H1 partial agonist. Okay. And then we have H1 antagonist. Partial agonist, they will incompletely block. H1 antagonist means completely block. Okay, now remember, H1 antagonist drugs, they are also known as antihistaminic drugs. So these drugs are all known as antihistaminics. So what is the definition of antihistaminic? The drug which block H1 receptor. Now the only drug we have which is an H1 partial agonist is betahistine. The drug name is betahistine. And where this betahistine is used? Betahistine is used in the treatment of vertigo. It is used in the treatment of vertigo. It comes with the brand name Vertin. Now, why it is used? Because it will act in ear. And in ear, remember, it decreases labyrinthine pressure. Hence, the vestibular nerves which get stimulated by labyrinthine pressure, they will not now stimulate, they will become normal. Okay, so just remember the word betahistine. Betahistine is used in the treatment of vertigo. Okay, now let's come to antihistaminic drugs. तो लेट्स मेक अ हेडिंग, द मेजर पार्ट दैट इज एंटीहिस्टामिनिक्स. ओके, नाउ एंटीहिस्टामिनिक ड्रग्स दे ब्लॉक H1 रिसेप्टर. ओके, नाउ दे आर डिवाइडेड इनटू टू. दे आर डिवाइडेड इनटू फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक्स एंड सेकेंड जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक्स. नाउ व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस बिटवीन फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंड सेकेंड जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट कंसेप्ट फॉर यू. ओके, तो लेट्स सी व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस. फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंड सेकेंड जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक. ओके, सो दे बोथ विल ब्लॉक H1 रिसेप्टर, दैट वी नो. दे बोथ विल ब्लॉक H1 रिसेप्टर, बट अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस लेट्स सी व्हाट इज द डिफरेंस. नाउ फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक, रिमेंबर, दे क्रॉस ब्लड ब्रेन बैरियर. दे क्रॉस ब्लड ब्रेन बैरियर एंड दे एंटर इन टू ब्रेन. दे एंटर इन टू ब्रेन. बिकॉज ऑफ दिस रीजन दीज फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक दे आर सिडेटिव ड्रग. दे प्रोड्यूस अ साइड इफेक्ट नोन एज सिडेशन. ओके, नाउ व्हाट अबाउट सेकेंड जनरेशन? दे डू नॉट क्रॉस ब्लड ब्रेन बैरियर, हेंस दे आर नॉन सिडेटिव. ओके, एक्सेप्ट देर इज वन सेकेंड जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक विच इज सिडेटिव. दैट प्लीज राइट द नेम ऑफ दैट ड्रग, दैट इज सेटेरिजीन. तो सेटेरिजीन इज द ओनली सेकेंड जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक विच कैन एंटर इन टू द ब्रेन एंड विच इज अ सिडेटिव ड्रग. ओके, नाउ लेट्स मूव फॉरवर्ड. द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज, अपार्ट फ्रॉम ब्लॉकिंग H1 रिसेप्टर, दिस फर्स्ट जनरेशन एंटीहिस्टामिनिक दे हैव एंटी कोलिनर्जिक प्रॉपर्टी एज वेल. दे हैव एंटी कोलिनर्जिक प्रॉपर्टी, दैट मीन्स दे ब्लॉक एसिटाइल कोलिन रिसेप्टर एज वेल. एंड सेकेंड जनरेशन यू विल राइट नो एंटी कोलिनर्जिक प्रॉपर्टी. ओके, नाउ बिकॉज ऑफ देयर एंटी कोलिनर्जिक प्रॉपर्टी, रिमेंबर, दे कॉज मेमरी लॉस. दे कॉज मेमरी लॉस. दे ऑल्सो कॉज ड्राई आईज, ड्राई माउथ. ओके, सो दीज प्रॉपर्टीज आर नॉट सीन विथ सेकेंड जनरेशन. And lastly, these first generation antihistaminic, they have additional, remember, anti-vertigo property. So we will discuss the drugs for the treatment of vertigo. They have anti-vertigo property. They have anti-emetic property. Because of anti-emetic property, they are used in various type of sickness. Like motion sickness, morning sickness, sea sickness, etc. And they also have anti-Parkinsonism effect. They are used in drug-induced Parkinson disease. They have anti-Parkinson disease. Okay. Now, what about these second generation? No such property. But we will write that this second generation antihistaminic, they have additional anti-allergic mechanism. They have anti-allergic effect. They will be having some additional anti-allergic effect also. Okay? So remember. So can we say that first generation antihistaminic, they cross blood-brain barrier and they are sedative, except here cetirizine. Now, there is one point we have to remember. Can we say that as first generation antihistaminic drug, they cause sedation? Because of this reason, these first generation antihistaminic, they are absolutely contraindicated in. A person will sleep in between. They are contraindicated in pilots, drivers, and machinery operators. So first generation antihistaminic, they should not be given in pilots, drivers, and machinery operators. No drug should be given. They are also contraindicated during daytime. apart from this profession. Okay, daytime, except one. The only first generation antihistaminic which you can give during daytime is chlorpheniramine. The only first generation antihistaminic you can give during daytime is chlorpheniramine. Why? Because it is least sedative. But it should not be given in pilots, drivers and truck operators or machinery operators. So it is least sedative. And can we say that these first generation antihistaminic, they cause memory loss? Okay, because of memory loss, it is harmful for, they are not avoided, but they are harmful for children because they will interfere with their learning capability. Okay, and they should be generally harmful for very old age, because in old age they are also cause increase in propensity of memory loss. And children, they will have learning disabilities. So these age group becomes more affected, most affected age groups. Okay, so if you talk about the least sedative, that is chlorpheniramine. But if there is a problem of sedation, remember, always give second generation antihistaminic. If you want to avoid sedation, give second generation antihistaminic, because second generation antihistaminic, they are non-sedative drugs. Okay, so let's classify these drugs. So let's first classify first generation antihistaminic. First generation antihistaminic, so which will enter into the brain. Let's see what are the drugs we have. So among first generation antihistaminic, we will divide them into three: highly sedative, moderately sedative, and least sedative. Okay, so first we will write the names. Among highly sedative, the first drug is promethazine. It comes with the brand name Phenargan. Phenargan, very famous name. Then we have hydroxyzine. It comes with the tablet Atarax. Brand name is Atarax. We'll also write diphenhydramine. It comes with the brand name Benadryl. Benadryl syrups, cough syrups, you know. Then you can write diphenhydrinate. And lastly, doxylamine. Okay. Then if you come about moderately sedative, we will write phenyramine. It comes with the brand name Avil. Okay. Ciproheptadine. Meclizine. And cinarizine. Cinarizine. Among least sedative, the overall least sedative drug which we have already written was chlorpheniramine. It was the least sedative first generation antihistaminic. But the least sedative overall are second generation. Other drugs are clemastine and tiprolidine. Okay. Now, the drugs which you must remember are promethazine, hydroxyzine, diphenhydramine, phenyramine. These drugs you must remember. And desedative, chlorpheniramine. So let's discuss about certain special properties of these drugs. Okay, so special properties. So the first point is, we will write promethazine. Less, more than diphenhydramine. Remember, these two drugs, they have maximum. So you'll write, among them, they have maximum anticholinergic property. So which two antihistaminic drugs, they have maximum anticholinergic property? Promethazine and diphenhydramine. Because of this reason, they are the drug of choice. फॉर ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ ड्रग इंड्यूस्ड पार्किंसन डिजीज. बिकॉज इन ड्रग इंड्यूस्ड पार्किंसन डिजीज द लेवल ऑफ डोपामिन रिड्यूसेस एंड एसिटाइल कोलीन इंक्रीजेस. सो दैट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज एक्स्ट्रा पिरामिडल सिम्टम. नाउ विच एक्स्ट्रा पिरामिडल सिम्टम्स दे आर द ड्रग ऑफ चॉइस और विच सिम्टम विल राइट दे आर द ड्रग ऑफ चॉइस फॉर एक्यूट मस्कुलर डिस्टोनिया. सो प्लीज रेफर टू द चैप्टर ऑफ एंटी साइकोटिक ड्रग वेयर वी हैव डिस्कस दैम. ओके, दे आर ऑल्सो गिवन इन मोशन सिकनेस. ओके, दे आर ऑल्सो गिवन इन द ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ वर्टाइगो विच इज जनरली सीन इन अ डिजीज नोन एज मिनियरीज डिजीज. ओके, बिकॉज दे हैव एंटी वर्टाइगो एंड एंटी एमिटिक इफेक्ट. ओके, इन सिकनेस. सो बिकॉज ऑफ देयर एंटी मस्करिनिक प्रॉपर्टी रिमेंबर देयर साइड इफेक्ट इज दे कॉज ड्राई आईज एंड ड्राई माउथ एंड दे कॉज यूरिनरी रिटेंशन. सो एंटी कोलिनर्जिक इफेक्ट दीज इफेक्ट्स आर नोन एज एट्रोपीन लाइक इफेक्ट बिकॉज एट्रोपीन इज एन एंटी कोलिनर्जिक ड्रग विच कॉजेज ड्राई आईज ड्राई माउथ एंड यूरिनरी रिटेंशन. ओके, नाउ दीज ड्रग्स रिमेंबर दे ऑल्सो हैव मैक्सिमम लोकल एनेस्थेटिक एक्शन ऑल्सो. दे हैव मैक्सिमम लोकल एनेस्थेटिक एक्शन ऑल्सो. Why they also inhibit certain sodium channels on nerves. Okay, sodium channels on nerves. Now let's talk about other drugs. We will write there is a drug known as hydroxyzine. Now hydroxyzine, remember, is a prodrug. Its active form is, the active form of hydroxyzine is cetirizine. Remember, hydroxyzine is first generation antihistaminic and its active form is cetirizine, which is a second generation antihistaminic. That is why cetirizine was the only second generation antihistaminic which has a sedative effect like hydroxyzine. Okay, it has a sedative effect. Now this hydroxyzine has a very good antipruritic action. It comes with the brand name Etaract. It has a very good antipruritic effect. Okay, let's move forward. Let's talk about now a drug, doxylamine. Now doxylamine is generally combined with a vitamin known as vitamin B6 or pyridoxine and this doxylamine is the drug of choice for morning sickness. Morning sickness is the vomiting which occurs during the first trimester of pregnancy. Okay? Okay? Morning sickness. It is the drug of choice. Let's talk about next drug. That is meclizine. Meclizine overall is the longest acting drug. Okay, and it is given in the treatment of seasickness as well as motion sickness. So remember, all these sickness, they arise from ear. Whether it is motion, whether it is morning, whether it is seasickness. When inside the ear, when our head is in motion, there is increase in labyrinthine movement, endolymph movement. This endolymph movement stimulate our vestibular nerve. And in this vestibular nerve, remember, we have H1 receptor and M1 receptor. H1 stand for histamine receptor, M1 stand for muscarinic receptor of acetylcholine. So if you will block this histamine receptor, this sensation will not be carried out. This vestibule go to cerebellum and cerebellum goes to CTZ area in the medullary, in the area prostrema, which leads to vomiting, nausea and vomiting. So it starts from ear. So we block this muscarinic and histaminic receptor. So that is why we give histamine for various sicknesses. We also give anti-muscarinic agent. That anti-muscarinic agent which is given for various sickness is hyoscine, which is also known as scopolamine. So anti-muscarinic and anti-histaminic drugs, they are used for the treatment of sicknesses. Okay. So there is one more drug which is given in seasickness, motion sickness, that is cinnarizine. Now this cinnarizine has a very important property. Apart from blocking H1 receptor, this cinnarizine also directly inhibit vestibular nerves. How it directly inhibit vestibular nerve? Cinnarizine, it inhibit calcium channels on vestibular nerves. Okay? So it inhibit calcium channel. So it's a very good drug for sicknesses. It inhibits calcium channel also, apart from blocking histamine receptor. Okay? So remember this part. Now the next drug we have is cyproheptadine. Now cyproheptadine, remember, we know it is an antihistaminic, first generation, because it blocks H1 receptor. It also has anticholinergic property. We know all first generation histaminic drug, they have anticholinergic property. They block the receptor of acetylcholine. But this cyproheptadine also has anti-serotonin property. It has also anti-serotonin property. Now, what does it mean? It means that cyproheptadine also blocks serotonin receptors. It also blocks serotonin receptor. Okay. Now remember one point. As it is blocking serotonin receptors, because of this reason, especially with serotonin receptor, you can write it blocks serotonin receptor are known as 5-HT. 5-hydroxytryptamine, 5-HT2 receptor. Because of blocking serotonin receptor, it is also used in the treatment of carcinoid syndrome. Or serotonin syndrome. When the level of serotonin becomes very high, we block the receptor by giving cyproheptadine. So it is the only antihistaminic drug which has an anti-serotonin property as well. Okay. And remember, when you block this serotonin receptor, remember it increases appetite. So some people, they generally used to take this drug to increase their body weight. But it is not an approved drug for this condition. Okay, it is not an approved drug. Okay, so remember about this drug, that is cyproheptadine. It is the only antihistaminic which has anti-serotonin property. Now remember, there is a drug known as doxepin. Now doxepin is not an antihistaminic. Remember, it's a tricyclic antidepressant drug. It's a tricyclic antidepressant drug, but it has antihistaminic property. Because of this reason, it is used in the treatment of allergic disease. So this doxepin, it has been approved for the treatment of allergy or pruritus. It is used to treat pruritus, which is seen in cases of atopic dermatitis. It's an allergic disease. It is also given for the treatment of pruritus seen in lichen simplex. It's a skin disease. So it has been approved, although it's a tricyclic antidepressant, but it has antihistaminic property. Now remember, what about the role of antihistaminic drugs in allergy? If you talk about anaphylaxis, which is the most severe form of allergy, okay, for anaphylaxis, we can give antihistaminic drugs. But remember, in anaphylaxis, the patient can go into shock and the patient may die suddenly. Hence, we cannot wait for antihistaminic drug to act. We have to give a very fast-acting drug. Remember, for anaphylaxis, we generally gave first intramuscular adrenaline or epinephrine, one and the same thing. Okay. Then we can also give, this is the drug of choice. Okay. Then we can maintain the patient on antihistaminic. So the first drug, remember, in anaphylaxis you will give is adrenaline because it will prevent the patient to go into shock. Okay. Now let's talk about now second generation antihistaminics. Okay. Second generation antihistaminic. Okay. Now, when we say a drug is a second generation antihistaminic, we will say when it will possess at least one of these property. If an antihistaminic drug possesses one of these property, at least one, we will say it is not a first generation, it is a second generation. Remember, it should not cross blood-brain barrier, or it should not enter CNS. Because of this reason, they are not sedative. But except there was a drug, cetirizine. Cetirizine is a sedative. Okay. Second point, they should not have anticholinergic property. Then we say it's a. And lastly, they should have additional anti-allergic mechanism. They must have additional anti-allergic property. If a drug is possessing any one of it, then we classify the drug as second generation antihistaminic. Okay. Now the point is, what is the use? The only use of second generation antihistaminic is they are used only as anti-allergic drugs. Their only use is anti-allergic drug. They cannot be given for motion sickness, morning sickness, vertigo, Parkinson's disease, etc. They are not used. They are only used as an anti-allergic drug. Okay. Now let's see what are the drugs we have. Okay. Let's see what are the drugs we have. So we will discuss the drugs one by one among second generation. First, we will discuss about two drugs. The first drug is esomeprazole. It was the one of the earliest second generation antihistaminic, esomeprazole, and terfenadine. Okay, terfenadine. These were the earliest second generation antihistaminic drugs. But remember, these drugs, they got banned. These drugs, they got banned. Now, why these drugs, they got banned? There is a reason behind it. Remember, these drugs in our body, they are degraded or metabolized. So they get degraded or metabolized by an enzyme in our liver known as CYP. CYP stands for cytochrome P3A4 enzyme in our liver. Normally, they are degraded by this enzyme. Now, at that time, when we used to combine these drugs with a drug known as erythromycin, an antibiotic, or ketoconazole, or ketoconazole is an antifungal drug. This erythromycin or ketoconazole, they inhibit this CYP3A4 enzyme. Because of this reason, they are not degraded in our body and their blood level increases. And if their blood level increases, they produce toxicity. And the toxicity produced by them was a very fatal toxicity. They produced fatal ventricular arrhythmias. Ventricular arrhythmia, or you can write fibrillations. Now, why this ventricular fibrillation occurs in the heart? The reason is these drugs, they block potassium channel on heart. These drugs, they block potassium channel on the heart. Remember, when we block potassium channel on the heart, there is increase in QT interval on ECG. There is increase in QT interval on ECG. And when there is increase in QT interval on ECG, there is a propensity to cause an arrhythmia known as torsades de pointis. And in torsades de pointis, the patient dies suddenly due to ventricular fibrillation. Okay? So how does potassium channel blockage causes increase in QT interval? Please refer to the videos of arrhythmias. Okay? There we have discussed the whole mechanism. But remember, these two drugs got banned because of the use of erythromycin and ketoconazole. Because erythromycin and ketoconazole, they are enzyme inhibitor. They inhibit CYP3A4 enzyme, which is responsible for removal or degradation of these drugs. Hence, when these drugs they get accumulated in the body, they cause torsades de pointis due to blockage of potassium channel on heart, which the patient was dying suddenly. So they got banned. Okay. Now, from this terfenadine, we made a active molecule. The active part of terfenadine is fexofenadine. From this terfenadine, we made a drug, fexofenadine. So fexofenadine is an active form of terfenadine. It comes with the brand name Allegra. Now this fexofenadine is an active form of terfenabidine. Earlier it was believed that it does not cause QT interval prolongation, but now it has been shown that it rarely causes increase in QT interval. It also is implicated to increase in QT interval, but this drug is available in the market. Okay. Now we will write that this fexofenadine is overall least or non-sedative antihistaminic drug. It has no sedative effect. Okay. And it also does not have any anticholinergic property. So second generation they don't have. Okay. It has least sedative and it has least anticholinergic property. So it is given for the treatment of various allergic conditions like pruritus, etc. Okay, let's talk about now next drug, that is loratadine. So loratadine is also a prodrug. Its active form is desloratadine. Okay, and you will write it is overall the most potent antihistaminic drug. That means it requires the least dose. Okay, least dose. Then we will write a drug, cetirizine. Okay. Now we remember, if you remember, cetirizine is an active form of first generation antihistaminic drug, hydroxyzine. It has been synthesized from hydroxyzine. Okay. Now cetirizine, remember, is a sedative drug. But remember, overall, it is the best or the most effective anti-allergic drug we have among antihistaminics. It has the best anti-allergic property we have. Okay? It has the best anti-allergic property we have. How? Because it blocks H1 receptor, that is done by all antihistaminic receptor, but it additionally inhibit histamine release from mast cells. It also inhibit eosinophil chemotaxis. It also inhibit the recruitment of eosinophil, which causes allergic reaction. So remember, there are three drugs which inhibit the release of histamine from the mast cells also. These three drugs are C, O, K. That is cetirizine, olapatidine, and ketotifen. So as these drugs, they inhibit this release from histamine from the mast cell, they are also known as mast cell stabilizer. They also have a property of mast cell stabilizers. So they stabilize mast cell and the histamine will not be released. Okay. But we know it is the only second generation which is a sedative drug. Because of this reason, we made a drug levocetirizine. Levocetirizine is the levo form or levo isomer of cetirizine. It requires half dose. It requires half dose. Because of this reason, it is less sedative. Okay. So it is also sedative, but less as compared to cetirizine. Okay. Let's talk about now other drugs. We will write rupatidine. Rupatidine. Rupatidine has additional property that it inhibit PAF. PAF also causes allergy, platelet activating factor. It also inhibit platelet activating factor. Okay. And there are many other drugs as well. You just have to remember their name, like mesolastine, ibastine, acrivastine. So they are ending with a similar name, astine. So these are the other second generation antihistaminic drugs we have. Now, for the treatment of allergy, we have developed certain topical second generation antihistaminic drugs. Topical means they are given as a drops, eye drops or nasal drops. So let's see what are the drugs we have among topical second generation antihistaminic. So we will write a mnemonic, koala. Okay. So the first drug we will write is ketotifen. Ketotifen, olopatidine, azelastine, levocarbastine, and lastly L-Keftadine. So these are the certain examples of topical antihistaminic drugs. Okay. So we'll write that this ketotifen is given intranasally also as a nasal drop for the treatment of allergic rhinitis. So nasal drops are given for the treatment of allergic rhinitis. Okay. And olapatidine is given as a nasal spray. Azelastine, it is also given as a nasal spray. Okay. And we will write that this azelastine is also given as eye drops or ophthalmic drops. Why eye drops? For allergic conjunctivitis. So they are also given as eye drops. Okay. So you just have to remember that these drugs are topical drug. You don't have to remember that which is given as a nasal spray, eye drops, etc. And among them, remember this azelastine has a maximum topical activity. It has maximum topical activity. So overall, these are the topical antihistaminic drugs we have. Okay. Which is given in the treatment of allergic rhinitis and allergic conjunctivitis. So this is all about antihistaminic drugs. Thank you very much.